Well, hello, my fifth and sixth grade friends. I look forward to seeing you to library, some of you, next week. But for now, here is the next half a chapter of 5 of Inkling. 2 steps inside the house and Ethan stopped cold. It looked like a chimpanzee with a paintbrush in each hand had cartwheeled down the hallway. There were colorful zigzags and red light bulb bulbs, but no chimpanzee could have also written giant words like blam and kaplow and thunk. Soren started giggling, but it was a nervous giggle. There was a movie like this when a guy goes berserk, and for a second Ethan wondered if his father had gone crazy, but then he thought, Inkling. Are you guys maybe redecorating? Soren asked. Ethan followed the colorful mess into the living room, then the kitchen and the dining room, searching for any signs of movement. Inkling, he whispered. Who's Inkling? Soren asked, wide-eyed. Ethan hurried back to the hallway, but froze when the bathroom door opened and Dad walked out. His father looked straight at him. Ethan looked straight back. His father's eyes flicked to Soren, and Soren stared back. A smile glued to his face. His heartbeat went thumpa 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 clumpa, counting down the seconds before his dad noticed the chaotic graffiti everywhere. But his oblivious father had grunted, walked back into his studio, and shut the door behind him. Ethan breathed again and rushed into his bedroom and recoiled because charging across the black wall was an enormous ape, beating its chest, throwing its head back and howling. In fact, it was silent, but in Ethan's head he heard everything. The thump of the meaty fist, the blood-curdling wail. What the? Said Soren. Shush, Ethan hissed, dragging him into the room and slamming the door. What is that? Soren squeaked. Because the giant gorilla, its head scraping the ceiling, was marching across the wall by the bed straight towards them. Inkling, Ethan said. Stop it! The gorilla paused and roared silently once more, and a speech bubble expanded from his mouth, and inky words wrote themselves in spiky letters. Why should I, you puny little human? Soren just stared. I am Kong, dreaded king of the jungle. As if demonstrating, a little biplane appeared from the shadow of Inkling's back and circled around his head. He pulverized it with his mighty fist. Inkling, you've got to clean up, Ethan told him. Give me one good reason why I should obliterate. If my dad finds out about you, he'll put you back in his sketchbook. Ethan didn't know where his threat came from, but it did the trick. Not the sketchbook, no! The giant ape collapsed like a burst balloon and fizzled back to a small splotch of ink on the wall. This is Inkling, said Soren, staring. Yep. What is it? Ethan didn't know how to describe him properly. Ink and energy and artistry and his father's imagination all mixed up in some kind of cauldron. Right now, all he could worry about was getting the walls and ceilings cleaned up. The hallway, he said to Inkling. Fast! While Soren listened outside Dad's studio, Ethan set Inkling on cleaning up duty and watched as he surged over the walls, erasing and gathering the ink back to himself. Ethan pointed at his father's vintage King Kong poster, now just a blank rectangle on the wall. He can redraw it, can't you? He remembered the way Inkling had been able to redraw his mother's photographs perfectly. From the wooden frame, Inkling cleverly slid underneath the glass so he was right on the poster itself. Here's what the hallway looked like. Pretty crazy. Inkling made himself into a long line and slowly rolled across the paper, leaving an exact replica of the movie poster in its wake. Whoa, said Soren. Ethan frowned and looked at the poster. Something was missing. He cocked his head at Inkling. The biplanes too, Inkling. Come on, spit 'em out. Reluctantly, Inkling coughed back up the biplanes that were zooming towards King Kong as he leaned out from the Empire State Building. Thank you, said Ethan. Now the rest of the house. Inkling was amazingly fast. He soared over all the graffiti on the walls, the ceilings, erasing it effortlessly. When he was finished, Ethan grabbed an old magazine from the coffee table and held it against the wall so Inkling could flow onto it. Ethan didn't even notice the extra weight. Inkling ricocheted around the edges of the cover, erasing it stroke by stroke. Why are you so excited, Inkling? Ethan asked as he and Soren went back inside his bedroom. I've been reading! So much action and color! What have you been reading? Ethan asked. He had a suspicion. Comics! Ethan opened his bottom desk drawer and peered inside at the massacred covers. He picked up a few comics up and rifled through them, seeing the half-eaten pages. Oh, geez, that's one of my brothers, Soren said. It was a candy factory to Inklin, Ethan said. At least it taught him to speak in full sentences. On the magazine cover, Inklin was still bouncing around like a pinball. Okay, I don't even think comics are good for you, Inklin. No, no, very good, they're very good. You need to calm down. Ethan went to the shelf and grabbed an old-looking book called Anne of Green Gables. His mother had given it to him, but he never read it because it was set in the past and it was about a girl, so he assumed it must be boring. Here, try this, he said. Inkling eagerly glided onto the first page and started erasing the type line by line. Ethan, Soren said, where did you find him? He came from my father's sketchbook. He told Soren everything. So let me get this straight, Soren said, watching as Inkling moved across the pages. He eats whatever he touches. Yeah, words, pictures. That's how he learned to read and draw. He can copy anything. How about TV? Or, Soren pulled out his phone and opened up to a picture of a beach with palm trees, and he put it down on the book in front of Inkling. Can you eat this, Inkling? Inkling bumped up against the phone and pulled back as if surprised. On the bottom margin of the page, he wrote, please don't interrupt me. I'm utterly enraptured by this glorious story. Why is he talking like that? Soren asked. It is truly sublime. I think he talks like that whenever he's reading, Ethan said. Inkling, we were just wondering if you could take a look at this picture. Reluctantly, Inkling became a splotch again and flowed onto the screen of Soren's phone. Too late, he discovered it was the same slippery stuff that covered the posters in the hallway. Inkling skated helplessly across the glass, but the image of the beach did not disappear or fade at all, even as he ricocheted back and forth a few times, hauling himself off the phone. He can't do screens, Soren said. Ink, said Ethan. Maybe it just has to be ink. Did you see anything, Inkling? Soren asked. Eagerly, Inkling flowed back onto the pages of the book and wrote, I saw nothing but a great aching darkness. It was horrid. Please, I beg you, never put me on such a terrible thing again. Ethan smiled as Inkling happily continued reading, erasing word after word. So, he's the one who did your drawing, Soren asked. Ethan nodded. Why didn't you just tell us you couldn't draw? Because you all thought I was some kind of genius. I cannot draw. It felt good to finally admit it. Well, I can't hit a baseball, said Soren with a shrug. Big deal. So, you just tell Inkling what to draw and he draws it? I don't need to, really. He reads your story, and I use my stick figures as a guide and did the rest. It's cheating, right? He watched Soren waiting for his reaction. I don't know. I mean, I saw Darren tracing stuff right off his phone. What's the difference? Ethan nodded. And yeah, did you see Susan H. characters? It's a total copy of Spider-Man. Exactly. And it's not like you're doing nothing. You rough out every panel with stick figures, right? You decide where the speech bubbles go. You're basically storyboarding the whole thing. I mean, I could rip up the first spread and start all over by myself, Ethan said. No, 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 said Soren. Pino and Brady have already started the coloring and the lettering. That's true, said Ethan. It wouldn't be fair to them. Not fair at all, Soren agreed. Are you going to tell your dad? Ethan shook his head. Not yet. And you can't tell him either, okay? Not Pino, not Brady. Of course not, Soren agreed. Can I see him draw? Sure. Hey, Inkling, would you mind drawing a bit of us? Inkling paused, and his sides rose, and he fell in what looked like a dreamy sigh. I feel like I've just made a great friend. I'm glad you like the book, Ethan said. Maybe I should read it. I urge you to. Are we friends, Ethan? It was the first time Inkling had used his name, and Ethan felt a surprise wave of happiness. Yeah, sure, we're friends, he replied. He took hold of the book and to carry Inkling over to his desk, and when Inkling flowed right onto his hand, he gave a small gasp. Inkling had never touched him before. He stared at the black splotch on his skin. It felt like almost nothing. Was it a bit cooler? Yeah, a little bit like a light breeze. I want a closer look at you, Inkling wrote on his hand. And then he seeped up Ethan's sweatshirt all the way to his shoulders. Ethan stood very still watching. Years ago in an eco reserve, a parrot had perched on him, and he felt the same nervous wonder now. Like a gust of cool wind, Inkling slid onto his neck. Ethan could hardly breathe. He felt like he was being explored. It was strange to think of himself as something alien, but he supposed he was to Inkling. Ethan walked over to his chest of drawers so he could watch in the mirror as Inkling flowed over his jaw, past his ear, and across his forehead. It was a little unsettling seeing a big black splotch at the top of his face. He shivered a little. Inkling slid down his nose and paused at the bottom, covering his nostrils. Ethan couldn't inhale. But before he could say anything, Inkling slid down over his mouth, too. His mouth was open and Inkling's body was like a black film, stopping air from coming in and out. Ethan, Soren said worriedly, are you okay? Panicked, Ethan slapped at Inkling. The ink seemed to understand and quickly bolted off his face, down his arm and to the chest of drawers. I couldn't breathe, Ethan panted. I'm so sorry, Ethan. You can't just go covering people's noses and mouths. I didn't know. I would never hurt you. It's okay. It was an accident, Ethan believed him. But he looked at Inkling with a new respect and a bit of fear. Inkling wasn't just a magical blob of drawing ink. He was powerful. If he wanted to, Inkling could suffocate him. Please forgive me. I am in the depth of despair. Ethan couldn't help but smiling. It's honestly okay. You don't have to be in the depths of despair. He looked over at Soren, who had taken several steps back from Inkling. It's okay, Ethan told him, unblinking friend. It is? I mean, we don't really know what else he's capable of. Who knows what kind of dimension he came from? My brother would know. He's in high school. He knows about all sorts of stuff like this. We could ask him. No, said Ethan. He was already starting to wonder if he shouldn't have told Soren. No one else needs to know. You trust him? Soren asked, nodding at Inkling. Absolutely. Inkling, are you ready to do another spread? My heart thrills at the idea. Ethan carried him over to the desk, where a fresh piece of illustration board waited. Wait till you see this, he told Soren. All right, fifth and sixth graders, I know that was a long chapter, but I wanted to finish chapter 5. Here's your question. Inkling now has the power to really hurt Ethan. He can cover his nose and his mouth and suffocate him really anytime he wants when he's sleeping or whatever. How would you feel about that? Now that you know that Inkling has a potential to, you know, do harm to you, would you be scared to have him around or would you still like him okay? Let me know in your notes. See ya.